Hi, I'm Andrew from Creative Guitar. I had a question that was emailed to me from off my website. And Vincent from New York writes in and he's asking, can you do a video that explains how to read music notation, not tablature, on the guitar? There are so many of the exact same notes on the neck that I can't understand how the process of where the notes should be played specifically actually works when a guitarist reads music notation. The first thing that I'd like you to think about in my explanation on this is I'd like you to get two perceptions of your music staff. One perception I'd like you to have is going from a low C, the first ledger line note below the staff, to a high A, and that would be the first ledger line note above the staff, and all of the notes in between. So that's going through your E and your G and B, D, F, and then of course the F, A, C, E space notes that are on the music staff. And I'd like you to think of that as one concept of your music staff layout of notes that you want to pay attention to. The other concept I'd like you to take into mind is the notes that are all ledger line notes below the staff, so all the low pitches on the guitar, like the low G and the low F and A even, or A flat, G flat, F sharp, those notes, including open E, of course. And of course, the notes above the staff on the high ledger line notes, like the high B, C, D, E, F, G, even up to, high A, ultra high A there. So I'd like you to think of that as another perception of your music staff. So we've got the perception of the first ledger line C note below the staff to the first ledger line note above the staff, the high A. And the other perception that we've got is of the low ledger line notes and the high ledger line notes above the staff that extend beyond those in the first category. So that's the first concept, is those two perceptions of the music staff. Now the next thing I want to move on to, just hold that thought and we're going to come back to it, but the next thing I want you to think about is how the guitar, in a real generalized way, and this is a very huge generalization, but I'd like you to think of the guitar neck as though it was 5 frets long, and that we had 3 principal positions on the neck, or layouts of it on the neck. Open to 5th, 5th to 10th, and then 10th to 15th. In open to 5th and 10th to 15th, that's where you're taking into consideration those really low or really high ledger line notes that we had in the second perception of our music staff. Between 5 to 10th frets, that's our interior region of our music staff, from that first ledger line, the low first ledger line note of C, to the high first ledger line note of A. So now you're starting to get a perception of how you can view your staff toward the guitar fretboard. Now, the next thing I'd like you to think about is just imagine for a moment that you got a piece of music, and the first section, let's say, just hypothetically, we'll say it's 12 bars long. The first section of that music, when you first got the notation and you're looking it over to read it, what you would do is scan it through and take notice of what the highest note in that melody is and what the lowest note in that melody is. And that will be the information that you can use to gauge where you're going to play it on the guitar fretboard. When you move on to the next section of music, then you can make a decision from the highest and the lowest notes of the music notation of where you're going to play that area. If you have to take the notes up an octave, perhaps, then you can make a decision of where they're notated originally and where they would be played. And more than likely, you'll probably be going between 10th and 15th frets to do something up an octave. But not always. It always depends on where those notes are sitting inside the music staff. So that's basically how you do it. Now, the thing that I want to pass along to you, this is just sort of my favorite reading position from right from the start when I get a new piece of music. I always gravitate towards the 5th fret on the guitar. So somebody hands me a chart. The first thing that I do when I begin scanning through the chart is I just instantly begin learning it off of the 5th position between 5th and 10th frets. And that's where I read the notation. if I start encountering a passage that goes quite high, well, then I'll begin making my decisions of position shifting to get me into those high pitches. Now, that works vice versa for if I'm going into low pitches as well. If I'm performing, you know, the piece and I start noticing that I'm moving into quite a few lower pitch notes, I'm going to begin making some decisions of how I'm going to flow through that melody to get to whatever lower pitch notes that I would require to play that particular section. So, in a nutshell, a lot of it just really comes down to that first couple of scans that you make through the notation that you're when you're reading it, and those decisions of where you're going to actually perform it on the neck. That will essentially lead you to how you're going to lay the tones out. You've got to keep in mind, you know, on the guitar, there's multiple places to play the exact same notated note on a piece of music, sheet music paper. So, you know, like for instance, an F, I'll just take an F note from here, first fret, first string. There's that exact same note about five frets higher over here on the second string, sixth fret, and then it reoccurs again over on third string, 10th fret, and then it reoccurs again here on the fourth string, 15th fret. And in about every five frets, you're getting that note reoccur on the neck again. So that gives you quite a bit of flexibility and options your way for how you're going to do fingerings. So and as an exercise idea, I would think that would be a really good thing for you to do. Scope out, I'll take a C here now, and just scope out the exact location of where all those notes are located. Then go and take another note, like take A, you know, scope out all the A notes and that are the unisons and find them on the fretboard. Another good thing to do if you haven't really buckled down and started it already is really learn at least 5 to 7 different ways to play your scales along the entire fretboard. You'll notice that unisons of scales can overlap. You'll get notes, unison notes overlapping. Let's say in a C major scales situation, you're going to get from if I start down low on the neck here, using some open strings, all of those notes just can reoccur with a new scale pattern. That one there I performed in second position. But then if I move over to fifth position, I can have all those exact same notes again here. If I go to seventh position, I can have all those exact same notes again. It isn't until when I get up around 10th position and I'm located in the much higher range that I really don't have access to those tones anymore, and I'm going to have to move up to a new octave to begin performing after that point. So there's a lot of good and a lot of value to taking, you know, a close look at your fretboard with scales and even with keys, like understanding that, let's say for instance, in fifth position, if I'm sitting in fifth position reading, that's a good flat key reading area. I've got easy access to B flat major, I've got E flat right there, F major's right there. But if I just slide down one fret lower to fourth position reading, all of a sudden I'm in a very good sharp key reading area. I've got easy access to A major, I've got E major right there, I've got D major, G major. So there's just immense value in really knowing your scales and really knowing your fretboard layout in terms of these unisons and how key centers work on the fretboard. It's just, you know, so important for really getting your head wrapped around music reading. And it might not seem in the beginning when you begin studying a lot of this stuff like there's a correlation, but there really is. So I hope that answers your question, Vincent, and I hope it's helped out other people as well. So by all means, if you have any further questions about it, just send me a quick email and I'll do my best to reply. I get a lot of emails, so if I don't reply right away, just hold tight. And if I don't reply at all, just send me another email. I won't mind if I'm getting duplicates, okay? So anyway, there you go. That should help you a little bit. Keep practicing this stuff and keep studying hard. It'll all come together. It's a little bit of a chore, but I usually find with people in music reading that if people really buckle down and study it, you know, for put some intense study into it, they can usually learn how to read quite well within about 2 to 2.5 years. So it all comes, but it, you know, just obviously takes the practice. So best of luck, and I'll see you on the next video. Take care. We'll see you next time.